set us free.
Christians have greeted each other one simple way on Easter morning. One has said, Christ is risen, and the other responds, Christ is risen indeed. So friends, I say to you, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Good morning and welcome to Crosspoint. My name is Amy Price. I'm your new director of Children and Youth Ministries. And on behalf of myself, Pastor Tom, the worship team, we want to welcome you to worship here on this Easter Sunday. I want to give you a quick introduction to what you're holding in your hand. If you want to take out your worship folder, if you flip it all the way to the back, you can see what to expect here at Crosspoint today. You'll see our order of worship, the music that we'll be singing together, as well as some instructions if you're looking for the nursery or a prayer room. We are going to be serving communion today, and Pastor Tom will talk to you a little bit more about that. If you open that all the way up, on the right-hand side, you'll see a communication card that is detachable. On the inside of that, you'll see today's date. If you're new or you're visiting with us, we'd love for you to fill that out. And if you want to be connected to a ministry, you can mark the appropriate box on there. The flip side of that is a prayer request card that anyone can fill out. You can mark on there confidential. Just Pastor Tom and the prayer team will pray over that. And then you can go ahead and tear that off and place it in the offering plate when it goes by. There's several announcements on the inside of your worship folder. I just want to share a few with you today. Following Easter, going into the month of April, we're moving into a new sermon series called Spring Training for the Soul. So Pastor Tommy will be walking us through kind of a baseball metaphor, looking for hitting for average, hitting for power, and going through there. So this is a great time when we have a new sermon series to invite someone new to church, to encourage you to do that. This Friday night, there will be a movie night here at the church. We'll be watching War Room at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. There's some more information about that in there. Next Sunday, April 3rd, there will be a parent and youth meeting from 6 to 7:30. So, like I said, I am the new director of Children and Youth Ministries. This is just about my first day. And many of you, many of the teenagers don't know me well, and I want the chance to get to know you and your families. So please do join us for that. Also, in your worship folders, there was an insert about small groups. If you're not a part of a small group ministry, I encourage you to take a look at that, to find something that fits with your schedule, and to get involved in that way. Finally, we want to thank all of you who purchased flowers in honor of or in memory of someone. Following worship today, you can come up to the front, pick up your flower, and take it home with you. That's all the announcements I have. I think we can get to the business of worship today.
Let's spend a couple minutes and greet somebody new today. Tell them Happy Easter. As we get started this morning, would you bow your heads and pray with me? Father, as we gather today on this celebratory morning, this day in which we remember the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I pray that we are focused on the cross and the work of your Son. Father, we thank you that we are brought in right relationship with you because of that work. On Friday, we had a service remembering the crucifixion, Lord, and today we celebrate the resurrection, but Lord, let us remember these aren't just things that happen in history. These are things that impact our lives at a deep level. So Lord, as we sing this morning, let us sing from that knowledge that we are free and alive and born in Jesus Christ. That we were once dead in our sin, but now we are alive through the grace and mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let's sing about that.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Of God was laid in darkness. Battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the storm was rolled away, his perfect love and God. We overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Now forever He is glorified. Forever He is living high. Forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive. Now forever He is glorified, forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive.
The ground began
to shake, the storm was thrown away, it's perfect love could not be overcome. Your sting, our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Now forever He is glorified, forever He is lifted high, forever He is risen. He is alive.
Sing that again. Forever He is glorified. It's good news. Let's sing it together. Forever He is glorified.
Now forever He is glorified.
is risen. He is alive. He is alive.
Lord, let that be our anthem this morning. We glorify that you are risen, and in that rising, Lord, we may find our hope for eternal life spent with you.
Now forever he is Lord, forever he is risen.
Sing it out forever.
Join the one who never
see limits. I can face tomorrow. We can see limits. Everything is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hand. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, everything is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hand. Amen. Amen. I'm alive, I'm alive, because he lives. My song join the one that never ends. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds my future, and life is worth living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone. Can change the leper's spots and melt his heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. I live. life shall still repeat.
Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the One who paid my debt and raised His life up from the dead. Oh, praise the One who paid my debt and raise His life up from the dead. Oh, praise the One who paid my debt. Raise His life up from the dead. Oh, praise the One who paid my debt. Raise His life up from the dead. Oh, praise the One who paid my debt. Jesus made it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
You may be seated. As we turn to our time of prayer, again, if you want to open up your bulletin, on the communication card, on the back of that card is an opportunity to share anything going on in your life that you want to lift up in prayer, both joys and concerns. Feel free to put them there. Please mark confidential if you don't want them shared in the bulletin next week or in an email that goes out during the week. Still will be prayed over, but just won't be shared in a public manner. If you open up your bulletin to the center section, just a couple to highlight that were lifted up this last week. Continued prayers for Sue Rhodes, that's Jada's aunt, as she's struggling with cancer. Also, prayers for the Haas family and also Kenny Ray Jr.'s family, both young men that passed away this last week unexpectedly, so dealing with their families. I think one was in their 30s and one was in his 20s, so just prayers for both families as they deal with that loss at this time. Also, prayers for people on spring break traveling. Spring break ends tomorrow for many in our area and begins for others in our area. But prayers for travel, that people get to and from their destination safely and that they have a good time in those places and get back home and get back in the routine and schedule of life again. The other prayers are there for you to look over and add to the different devotions that you do during the week and the different prayer time that you have on your own. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Gracious God, it is truly a gift to be here this morning. We're here because of what You did so long ago on this day. When they went to the tomb and it was empty. And You had risen. And You proved to all of us that You were going to do what You said You were going to do. So for years and years, we've come to worship because of that. Because of Your love. Because of Your forgiveness. Because of the new life You offer us today. So God, we're thankful that as we come this morning to praise, that there are so many things going on in our lives that we have to lift up in joy for. God, sometimes those moments go by and we think that we don't need to say thank You or we don't need to lift You up in praise. But today, Help us to do that. Help us to find the individual things that happened to us this last week or maybe even this last month. The ways that you nudged us, the ways that you wrapped your arms around us, the ways that you let us know that you were there and active in our lives. And sometimes they happen so quickly that we just move on to the next thing. But today, just help us to pause, to give you glory, to give you honor. No matter how big or small we think that moment may have been, it was a moment with you. And for that, we praise you. God, we also know that when we come together in worship, that we have different things going on in our lives that we need your help with. And we can get all dressed up and we can put smiles on our faces, but each one of us have something we need your help with. So help us to be honest enough with you today that we can name it to you, God. Whatever it may be. Maybe it's a broken relationship that we're trying to mend. Maybe it's a health concern and it just seems to be difficult more and more. Maybe it's dealing with the loss of somebody close to us. Maybe, God, it's fighting an addiction or temptation that continues to win. Maybe this morning, God, somebody's dealing with job stress or financial concerns. Maybe today, God, we're just dealing with frustration. That we've prayed and we've waited for responses and they just don't seem to come as quickly as we'd like. So we're frustrated, God. Whatever our concerns may be today, God, help us to place them at your feet. And help us to know that when we place them at your feet, that you do hear us, that you do respond to us, and that you want to be active in our lives. So grant us the patience, God, to wait for those responses, because they don't always come as quickly as we'd like. And then, God, grant us the wisdom and the courage to be able to do what you're asking us to do, no matter how difficult it may be. God, it truly is a gift to be in this place, to gather with friends and family, to praise you, to celebrate you, and to know that you hear us. So continue to hear us this morning, God, as we pray the way you taught us and we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
So our greeters come forward to receive our offering today. If you're with us for the first time, we want this service to be our gift to you, for an obligation for anything in the baskets as they go by. Consider Crosspoint your church home. You know that the offerings we give go to continue to share God's love with the world in practical ways. Also at this time, our Jam Kids, which are second grade and down, will head back for a time of worship and praise. But before they go, we like to pray over them. So let's pray over our Jam Kids. Gracious God, we thank you for the energy that our kids bring to our lives and bring to our church and to our worship. And now, God, as they go, we just ask that you be with their teachers, that they can help them grow closer to you and closer to one another. In your name we pray. Amen. Jam, second grade and down, can head back with Rosemary today and Sherry.
For every curse, you're the cure. For every sickness, you're the healer. Every storm, you're the calm. For all that's lost, oh, what a Savior. And on that cross of Calvary, every burden has been defeated. Every wretched heart redeemed. You drown our sins in seas of crimson. Hallelujah, death is beaten. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, it is finished. All for you, the highest praise. not tarry. Every shackle will come undone. My soul in love, but is the kingdom. Hallelujah, death is beaten. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, it is finished. All to you, the highest praise. Hallelujah, death is beaten. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, now and forever. All to you, the highest praise. Where there was sin, your love rushed in. Where sin runs deep, your grace runs deeper. For all enslaved, the ransom paid. Light up the world, yours is the power. Where there was sin, your love rushed in. Where runs deep, your grace runs deeper. For all enslaved, the ransom paid. Light up the world, yours is the power. Hallelujah, death is beaten. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, it is written all to you, the highest praise. Hallelujah, death is beaten, Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, now and forever, all to you, the highest praise.
Let us pray. Gracious God, open our heart to feel your presence. Open our ears to hear your voice. Open our eyes to see your face. Allow the words of my mouth, the meditation of all of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Give me this one. Thanks. Continuing on in our John series, through Lent, we've been looking at John and the whole gospel, and we've had different chapters that we've been reading each week and different things that we've been doing. If you have not had a chance to read any of John yet, I would encourage you this week to pick a chapter and start reading a great gospel and a wonderful illustration of how God was at work and is at work in our lives at this point. Every Easter, we read a similar passage. There are four gospels, and each one of them has a different passage and a different take, if you will, on what happened at the resurrection. Today we're going to read from John, of course, beginning in chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth, and had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went on to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them what he had said these things to her. I want to look a little bit to see how we compare to Mary Magdalene today. A little bit about Mary Magdalene. It's thought that she was single. And the reason they think that is because of the way that her name is said in the scripture. It's Mary of Magdalene or Mary Magdalene. If she were married, it would have been Mary the wife of, or if she had children, Mary the mother of, just the way that they do and tell about people. But since it was simply Magdalene, the thought is that's where she came from. Mary also had a troubled past. If you read in other parts of scripture, specifically in Luke 8, as Hamilton says, Luke tells us that she had seven demons. Now, a demon in the first century could be anything from an unexplained physical illness to a psychiatric disorder to an addiction of some kind. It also indicated a deep spiritual wrestling that might have involved an actual spiritual entity. Any of these meanings could have been covered by the word demon. So she wasn't a person that had a wonderful past and everything had gone great for her, and here she met Jesus and everything was wonderful. She had some demons, literally and figuratively, in her past. We're each a little like Mary in that sense. We all have a past. We all have some degree of trouble or some degree of discomfort or some degree of something that has happened in our past that gets us to the point we're at. And it's different for each one of us. I mean, some of us, perhaps, have had broken relationships. Relationships that we thought were going to last forever, and then something happens, and they don't. Perhaps we have a physical illness, and we thought we were fine, and everything was healthy, and everything was good, and then all of a sudden we have that appointment with the doctor, and we're not. Perhaps we've made wrong choices. Perhaps we're fighting addictions or temptations. Perhaps we have emotional struggles in which we deal with depression or anxiety. Perhaps we've had some spiritual pain that's taken on us. And we just at times don't know where our faith is and don't always know where God is. All of us have a past. All of us have something that gets us to this point that hasn't been perfect. Just like Mary. But Mary's life was changed by Jesus. Everything with her terrible past, she became a follower of Jesus. So even though she had all that stuff, when she met Jesus and came to know Jesus, everything changed. And her future was different. And it can be with us as well. Our lives can be changed when we meet Jesus. So Mary comes to the tomb in the early morning. It says early morning, so it says it was still dark. So some of you don't even know what morning looks like when it's dark, but it's pretty early. Especially with spring break this last week, many of you don't know what morning looks like when it's dark. And she's the first one to the tomb. She's the first one that finds it empty. It's interesting that John, she's the one with the troubled past, and yet she's the first one that gets up to go and see where Jesus is at. And she tells the disciples, They come running, they check, and then I'm always surprised by this. They go back home. I mean, it's like this happens every day. It's like, yeah, we went, we checked it out, he wasn't there, but brunch is right around the corner. We got to get back for it. And they go home. But Mary stays, and she begins to cry. She cries uncontrollably. She's upset. She's upset that Jesus died, and she's dealing with all that grief. She's upset that he's not there, and she thought he was going to be there, and she doesn't know why. She's upset with frustration, and she just cries. And it's interesting to me, even seeing two angels inside the tomb doesn't stop her from crying. She's just in such deep sorrow. We all have times spent crying. And maybe it's been a long time since you cried. Maybe it's just been the other day that you cried. But we all have moments in our lives where we cry. We get hurt physically, and maybe we break something, and the tears come even if we don't want them to. Or we get frustrated beyond words, and we don't know what else to say, so the tears just flow. Maybe we face death of people close to us. Or we deal with difficult people who say hurtful things, and the only response we have is tears. Maybe there's moments when we just get overwhelmed with life, and we don't even know why, and we just cry, and the tears flow. Sometimes the only thing we can do is just sit down and sob, just like Mary did. We know that sorrow. We know that pain. We know that hurt. And the tears sometimes are hard to wipe away. Sometimes we just can't get them to stop even if we want to. And we wonder, when are they ever going to stop? When am I going to feel better? When am I going to be whole? When am I not going to feel this anguish? That's what Mary thought as she's sitting there that Easter morning. And then something happens. Jesus calls her by name. He said to her, Mary. One word changed everything. It stopped the tears. It caused her to look up. It caused her to see him. Jesus knew her name. There's something comforting about when someone calls you by name. I mean, it's an intimacy, or it's in a relationship that they know you well enough, that they know your name and they call you by name. It's always interesting when you get a telemarketer. Some of them have tried to get to know you better by calling you by name as soon as you answer. You'll pick it up and they'll say, yes, is Melissa there? And you're thinking, don't recognize the voice. Don't think she wants to talk to this person. But for some reason, when they call you by name, they think you're going to say, sure, she's right here. And no, we don't want to buy a dinosaur today. But by calling someone by name, it lets us know that we know them, that we care for them, that we're familiar with them. And Jesus knew Mary. He wasn't a stranger. Jesus knows each one of our names. He knows our names. He knows what we've been up to. He knows what our past looks like. He knows what our future. He knows all those things about us, and he calls us by name because he loves us and he wants to get our attention. He wants us to know he's there. Then Mary recognizes Jesus. Mary knew his voice as soon as he said, Mary. And she looked up and she saw his face and she knew his face. And all of a sudden, everything was different. Everything that Jesus had said was going to happen, all of a sudden she knew it was. He had risen. Death was conquered. Sins were forgiven. Her tears, all of a sudden, turned to joy. That's what happens when we recognize Jesus in our midst, when we see him around us. So will we recognize the risen Jesus this year? Will we recognize him? Will we know his voice? Will we see his face? Will we know it's him? The difficulty is sometimes we wish if we were only there, we would have recognized and heard him because he was actually right there and we saw and she saw and she knew. But the reality is Jesus is all around us. Jesus is often heard and seen in each one of us. We just have to recognize it. This last week, I had been, our family has not been to the ER in probably 13 years. And we decided this last week that we'd go twice. The first one was one of my sons, the younger one, and he had decided that he would skateboard, and the road turned and he didn't. So hit his head, and had a still has, I don't know when they go away, a mild concussion. So he and I went down to the emergency room and hung out for an afternoon, and got brain scanned, and everything was normal, supposedly. And home we came. Well, then, not to be outdone, my wife then, on Thursday night, decided, hey, since you've got to take Bailey and I didn't get to go, I really want to check this place out. It sounded really cool. So she laid down to go to bed, and her heart was doing something that she wasn't familiar with. And it wasn't just fluttering for me. It was something different than that. And she thought, well, we better go get this checked. So after a while, she called people and finally convinced to go back. Fine. The heart is fine. Everything's fine. All the tests came out normal and all that. So we drive down. And, of course, none of these things ever happen at, like, a real decent hour or nice time of the night, day, evening. And you're like, hey, got a couple minutes this afternoon. Why don't we just head down? Now, this was 11:30. So on the way down, I texted someone, and I said, hey, are you working tonight? And it was at a stop sign that I texted. The light was red. I was sitting there, and I texted. And the person said, no, I'm off tonight. What do you need? And I said, well, we're just taking a tour and going down to the ER for a little bit. And they said, oh, okay, let me know how things go. So we're there, and we're sitting in the waiting room. I love that name. I mean, whoever wants to go to a waiting room, you know you're going to be. I mean, it's not like we're going to move you through the line room. It's not like you won't be here long room. It's a waiting room by design. You're going to wait. So we were sitting there waiting, and I get a text from this person. And they say, what would you like to drink? And I thought, well, that's odd. I mean, I'm sitting, I look around. I mean, are there cameras? And I said, what? Thinking that maybe the person had texted the wrong person. As sometimes happens, I've done that. And they said, no, what would you like to drink? And Mel said, I could really use a water. So I said, water's fine, and surprise me. And 5 minutes later, this person comes around the corner with a couple bottles of water, and they were drinking a glass of pop. 12 o'clock. And we're thinking, what are you doing here? He said, well, I was up, so I thought I'd come down. And the person stayed with us. We got home around 3, and they stayed until they found out everything was all right and left at 2:30. A text just to say, are you working? See, sometimes Jesus is all around us, and we just don't recognize it. We don't recognize the voice. We don't recognize the face. And we move on and say, no, I didn't see Jesus today. No, I didn't hear Jesus today. No, I didn't have him with me today. People often reach out a hand or speak a kind word, and we need to accept. See, in the midst of our tears, in the midst of our sorrow, in the midst of our not knowing what was going on with Melissa's heart, this person was there. And it made the time go so much faster. And it eased both of us. And relaxed us. See, people reach out to us in our moments of anguish, in our moments of tears, in our moments of sitting and crying, and we have no idea why, and we just need to accept it. We need to recognize that's the risen Jesus working, and we need to extend our hand and say, thank you. That's what I need. That's what I long for. That's what I want. We also need to be Jesus for other people. To not just walk by someone with tears. To not just say, I really don't have time for that, but to make time for that. To be there. See, life is still going to be hard. I mean, just because Jesus rose from Doesn't mean tears are going to stop. Doesn't mean death is never going to happen again. Doesn't mean we're not going to be in pain and we're not going to hurt and we're not going to lose people close to us. We still have death. We still have sin. We still have sorrow. But when we recognize the risen Jesus, we have life. We have forgiveness. We have hope. That's what changed when the tomb was empty. That's what changes today. Easter morning changed everything for Mary, and it changes everything for us. Everything Mary thought about death, sin, and sorrow changed. Now we get to experience new life. Now we get to be forgiven. Now we get to see the hope that is there. Now we have the risen Jesus. Let's recognize the risen Jesus at work around us and through us this Easter year. Because he's there, waiting to surprise us, waiting to call us by name, waiting to help us. Will we reach out to him? Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you for this day. For this day that we celebrate the end of death and sin and sorrow and the beginning of life, forgiveness and hope. Help us to recognize you in each other, God, and then help us to be you for the world. In your name we pray. Amen. One of the gifts that he gave us was the wonderful sacrament of communion, in which we remember so long ago when his disciples sat around with him. And as they were sitting there, he was sharing with them what was going to happen and what would take place. And as he did, he picked up a piece of bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat in remembrance of me." And they did. They didn't quite know what it meant, but they did it anyhow. And then after the meal got going a little while, he then picked up the cup and he said, "This is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take, drink in remembrance of me." And likewise, they took and they drank. And at that moment, he shared his love. He shared his forgiveness. And he shared himself with each one of us for centuries. So every time we come to the table, we come once again remembering that Jesus does love us, that Jesus does forgive us, that Jesus did die for each one of us so we would have new life and new hope. And that's what this sacrament means. Let us pray. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us your body redeemed by your blood today. Fill us, God, that we may experience this sacrament and go away from this table different than the way we came to it. In your name we pray. Amen. The people helping me with communion come forward. We use a method of intinction in which when you come forward, you'll take a piece of bread, you go ahead and dip it into the cup, and then you go ahead and sit back down. We have focused prayer. If there's something going on in your life that you want to lift up in prayer today, we have somebody in the back by our prayer banner that would love to pray with you. We will have four stations, obviously the two up front, and then we'll have two in the back, so find the station closest to you. In the United Methodist Church, all are welcome to receive communion if you earnestly hope to grow closer to Christ and want Him to be a part of your life.
How deep the Father's love was, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. The pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, His wounds which mar the chosen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, what a gift. The gift of your love. The gift of your forgiveness. The gift of your resurrection. And now, God, help us to go away from this table different than the way we came today. To share that love and forgiveness with others. And to celebrate your resurrection. In your name we pray. Amen. As we conclude our time of worship today, if you're with us for the first time, we would love to have you stop by our welcome table, which is out the doors on the left-hand side right behind the welcome banner. We have a gift we'd love to share with you and answer any questions you may have about the ministries here at Crosspoint. Also on the back table, a couple different things to sign up for, small groups, different mission projects going on. So stop by at the table and find ways to get involved in the life of Crosspoint. As you go today, remember, Jesus is all around us. He's risen. Go now and recognize him.
Those dazzling hearts to find.